Do not be afraid, O flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. I don't know about you, but maybe it's because I've read Luke so many times and have such an affinity for this particular gospel, that whenever I hear the words, do not be afraid, it takes me back to those shepherds sitting out in the middle of the wilderness under a starry sky, and all of a sudden, like Close Encounters of the Third Kind, the light comes down on them, and they're freaked out. And the first words of the angel are, do not be afraid. This makes me think that every time you hear the words, do not be afraid, you really should probably be really afraid, right? So the fact that Jesus is saying, do not be afraid right here, kind of harkens to, uh-oh, something's coming, right? And that something that's coming are some of the most challenging words that we hear in Luke's gospel, but also some of the most grace-filled and loving words that we get in Luke's gospel as well. Here's what I'm thinking about. Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. What more a promise do we need than that? It is God's pleasure to give us God's kingdom. What kind of kingdom, what kind of ruler does that for any of the people that he or she's ruling? To say, hey, it's my kingdom to give you, you have it. Think about that. What kind of a God, what kind of a person, what kind of anything you can think of is so willing to give up power and share it with everyone so readily? No other God except ours. Think of every king you've ever heard, every queen you've ever heard, all the one of you is taking more power. Not what's mine is mine, and what's yours is also mine, right? And then you get a bigger kingdom, right? Not so with our God. Our God says, it is God's pleasure to give you God's kingdom. And then come the rest of things that probably should make us pray, right? Like, do not, you know, don't store up for treasure things on earth but in heaven, and where your heart is, where your money will be, and all those good things. They really are great stewardship sermons. I promise I'm not a great stewardship sermon. Although I want it to be a little bit. I mean, it's in the inside, I want it to be a little bit. I can't let you go on it, but I'm going to try. So I was thinking about this, and immediately we got this good pleasure, and God wanted to give God's kingdom to us. And immediately made me think of one of my favorite movies of all time, which is Lawrence of Arabia. If you've seen this movie, you know what's so wonderful about this is that it's all shot without any CGI. This is before, you know, digital imaging, before you could make 20,000 soldiers in the desert march out and make them only like five guys and then multiply them. When there are 10,000 camels riding out into battle in the desert, there were 10,000 camels riding out into battle in the desert. It's amazing. And there's one scene in the movie in particular that always comes back to me, and it's Lawrence of Arabia is sitting with one of the other chiefs. He's trying to convince this kind of outlaw guy to come join him in this, what seems like an impossible battle. It's to take the town of Acre. And Acre is great because it's a port city and then the British could come in. It's during World War I, right? And so he needs to have these guys come do this impossible thing. And he's got to try and convince his warlord, who has all the money, who has all the food, who has all the guys, to come join him in what seems like a futile task. And at the end of the day, Lawrence of Arabia leans over and says to Abba, he's a real guy, by the way, he says to Abba, he says, Abba's not going to come because of the money. He says, no, I have money. Abba's not going to come because he needs more wealth. No, because Abba lives. Abba's not going to come because he needs to show off what a warlord he has. No, I have great. He says, Abba is going to come because it is his pleasure to take Abba out. And the look on Abba's face, he's like, and then he says, oh, you won't trouble me like women. And he says, I will go because it is my pleasure. It is God's pleasure to give us God's kingdom. Not because God is great, not because God has all the wealth, not because God created everything. No, but because it is God's pleasure to give it to us. I think in reading this passage, there are three things that come down to what faithful discipleship is about. The first is fear. The second is treasure. Now, fear part is not about being afraid, but it's about actually being without fear. And why you're without fear is because you've been created by God that loves you so much in your life that God wants to give you all that is God's. Think about that. You don't have to be afraid. The things that we find that are that hold us down in our lives, the things that we find that weigh us down, usually have to do with scarcity. God is not about scarcity. God is about abundance. God is about how little we have. God is about how much God can give. So we don't have to be afraid anymore because that is the God who is there for us, who loves us so much that God will give everything for us, even God's self on the cross, even God's kingdom. Fear. Treasure. Now, treasure is a good one because I think it's something that we have that we think is a finite thing, right? My bank account has current amount of treasure, right? Or in my heart, I know that I feel amount of happiness or love or treasure towards somebody else, right? What God is talking about is where is the source of your treasure. It's identifying your worth and your identity as treasure. And if you put yourself in as treasure, you are of infinite value. Now, one of the things that's interesting, I promise it wouldn't be a spiritual sermon, I'm going to try and get on this baptism, but one of the things that I find to be very interesting exercise in terms of discipleship and what you give and how you give it. Any good CFO can tell you that by reading a company's balance sheet, reading their ledger, you can tell exactly what the company's morals and ethics are. You can see what the company believes in. You can see what the company holds as valuable. And you can see how the company operates, updates on all those principles combined, and what's the general scope of the company, right? What does your balance sheet look like for where you give? Yeah, I thought. Do this exercise in your head. I did it in mine this morning, and I think in my household it comes down to the first place where we have expenditures of treasure are towards having a roof over our head every month. The second is we give to our church. The third is we give to University of Mary Washington, where my son is currently enrolling in college. Those are our top three things. What are your top three things? What are the three things that you give the most to? Because if that's where your heart is, where your treasure is, then what are those three things? What does that tell you about where your heart is? And how much are you giving and how much are you worth based on what you give to others or what you or you spend money on? I think Luke is asking us to take an account of this, and I think that like most things in Luke's gospel, it is a kind of a daunting task. You sit down and think about it, you're not troubled a little bit by those numbers or those thoughts. Maybe you should take a little another deeper look at what it is that you're asking yourself. That's treasure. Knowing the source of your treasure and your identity and your worth. And finally, it comes down to preparation. Jesus spends a whole lot of time and will for about the next 10 or so chapters in Luke's gospel talking about what it's like the kingdom and how to prepare ourselves as disciples to be partners of that kingdom. And this morning, he's talking about what makes you prepared to be a participant in this kingdom. All right, so to be a participant in this kingdom, you have to be prepared for any time that God shows up in any way, shape, or form, because it won't be when we think. It probably won't be like 11:30 or 11:45 in the morning on Sunday after we come home from church, we're having brunch, and God's going to arrive. It's probably not going to be then. It's kind of probably going to be when we least expect it. It's probably going to be when we, through someone, we won't think that it'll be God showing up. But my brothers and sisters, I bet you that every day you have God show up to you somewhere in an unexpected way. In fact, I can guarantee you that God shows up to you, both as someone in need, but also as someone of joy. We don't see the producing of God as showing up to someone in need and never help. What about God showing up to someone in joy? Showing up to something that is triumphant and wonderful and amazing and lightning. Because that is how God works. In both of those realms, in the realms of we need to give of ourselves to be the partner of the kingdom, but also maybe we need to just rejoice that the kingdom of God is coming to us. In those wonderful, unexpected moments of joy that happen throughout our day, all the time, if our eyes are open for them. Finally, what I want to talk about
not just fear and treasure when we
prepare about discipleship, because God doesn't make a promise. And we hear this promise in the story of Abram. If you look at the front cover of the Milky Way, the front cover of your bulletin, that picture is actually taken just south of the mountains by a photographer a couple months ago. I don't know who the photographer is. I found this randomly going through a Google image search for pictures of the Milky Way. And it's amazing that this person actually was able to take this image from the west bank of Annapolis, a little bit south of Annapolis. But God's promise to Abram is, yeah, it doesn't seem possible that you should have a son. But not only will you have a son, there'll be more, your descendants will be more in number than the stars. And what Jesus is promising us today is that if we are ready, if we know not to be afraid, and if we figure out where our treasure is and what our value is in God's creation, and truly believe that, that God's promise is God's kingdom. What promises do for us is they help to create a whole host of things, primarily relationship. If I promise you something, we're in a relationship, right? If I promise you something, that means that we have joined identity or a joined mission around something that's going to be a future event. If I promise you that next Sunday I'm going to preach in 5 minutes, my gosh, you have something to look forward to, right? It gives a bond between the giver and the receiver. It gives a bond of something that's a shared anticipation. It creates hope. It creates relationship. And this promise that God is going to give us God's kingdom is pretty much the ultimate relationship giver. Our job as disciples of Jesus is to figure out that we shouldn't have any fear, to figure out where it is that we get our worth and our value, and how it is that we deal with that both in a monetary way, but also as ourselves. How do we give of ourselves? And finally, it means that we have to be sure that we're prepared for when the kingdom comes, we'll do nothing